I've got something a little bit different for you today. I've got a modem from the dawn of personal computing. This sucker is a Gandalf SAM24 2400 baud modem. Actually, it could do 300, 1200, or 20, or the high speed 2400. And this thing, shockingly, was actually made in Canada. Specifically by a company in Ottawa, Ontario called Gandalf, who started up in the 70s and got bought out in the 90s. They made a bunch of different types of modems. They also made some PBX stuff, which is like office switchboard kind of telephone equipment, and they made taxi dispatch kind of equipment. Interesting mix. But anyways, I've got my hands on this thing, so I'm gonna rip into it. And you can see how huge this thing is, so it doesn't, well, okay, so my cutting mat here is what, 16 inches wide. This thing is about 14 inches this way by 11 inches that way. It's freaking huge. I mean, the Hayes modems were about the size of that thing near the end of their life, near the end of the life of dial-up. So, anyway, I'm gonna rip into this thing and just take a little peeky look at what's inside. Now, it comes apart pretty easily, actually. It just undo those two screws, and the board slides right out. And there's nothing in the case, it's just completely hollow. That's heavy. So, here it is in all its glory. That's pretty busy, isn't it? So the power supply, they saved themselves some time and effort by just using a wall wart that already, from a third party that already had its CSA approval and UL approval. This thing puts out 18 volts AC at 12 VA for, close enough, 12 watts. So center tapped. The reason center tapped is important is because that allowed them to generate a dual polarity power supply in here, so positive voltage and negative voltage, with reference to ground or 0 volts. Why would they want to do that? Normally, the only thing that you're going to need in this type of chip, in this era of chips, the only time you're going to need a dual voltage power supply or dual polarity power supply is if you're driving an op amp, such as this MC, what is it, MC3403 op quad op amp. So what he's doing, I'm gonna guess, is amplifying the signal going out towards the telephone line. Here's two telephone jacks on the back here, just in parallel. Telephone set and telephone line. Those are just the standard RJ11 jacks that you'd have on any wireline phone. And then, so they'll be connected in parallel, just so that when the modem is not working, not operating, you can use the telephone as telephone. Because back then, telephone lines, especially business telephone lines, were horrendously expensive. Anyways, so Mr. Op Amp would be driving signal from that was generated from the rest of this through the transformer, which we used to isolate and line match to the telephone line, and then out to the telephone line through one of these two little relays, which would take it on hook and off hook. On hook and off hook is literally, you take your telephone, you hang it up, that's on hook, you pick it up, that's off hook. Anyway, so that's, I'm just kind of getting random here. Another interesting thing about this board, after that, is the whole board is on a big edge connector here, so that they could undo these two screws here, take that whole back piece off, and mount this card and a bunch more like it in a card cage in a 19-inch rack. And then they would power it, power the whole rack, with something like this, the DC to DC converter module that would power the whole rack of them. But we'll take a look at this in a future video. If anybody's interested in power supplies, that is. So, what's going on the board? Well, there's four, five big chips and then a whole bunch of little ones. Most of these are 7400 series logic chips. So there will be inverters and logic gates and whatnot in between the control signals coming off the serial port here from the computer and the processor. The processor, main processor right there, an Intel 8051, which is an 8-bit microcontroller or microcomputer, actually, as the data sheet says. The other big guys, Intel 8251, which is a UART, Universal Asynchronous Receiver Transmitter. That's the one that actually handles the serial communication. That is an EEPROM, which has the program on it. It's a 128K Intel EEPROM, D27128, if you care to look at the datasheet. EEPROM, erasable programmable read-only memory, that way they can reprogram the whole thing just by replacing that chip. And you notice that it's the only one on the board that's socketed. So if they decided they needed to do a firmware update, these days you'd just flash it, right? But back then, you'd pop this guy out, gently with the wrong tool. Come on, get out. And you would take the label off, revealing a little window in there. Julie and I and Big Clive have done videos on these things. I'm not going to shred it, but there is a little window underneath there that you shine UV light in for a while. That would erase it. Then you'd put it into a special programming adapter that's connected to your desktop computer. And using special programming voltage, in this case, 12.5 volts, and normally the whole board's running on 5 volts. So use 12 volt programming voltage and a special programming adapter to dump your new program into there, and then you plug her back into the board, and hey, presto, one upgraded modem with new software. Given how much of a pain that was, they didn't, back in the day, they generally did a lot more quality control. I put that in backwards. They did a lot more quality control on the software before they dumped it in, because, I mean, these days, deploying a patch or an upgraded firmware is a piece of cake over the net, right? But back then, you'd either have to send out a whole bunch of new chips to your customers and have their techs replace them, or you'd have to bring them all back into the factory. And who wants to do that? Or send your techs out. Again, who wants to do that? What a pain. Anyway, that was a digression. What else we got going on this board? This thing is a ZY-S3009A, which I could not find any information on anywhere in the internet. Shocking, I know, but the internet doesn't actually know every single thing. Especially when it comes to 1980s computer hardware, I guess. The other big player on here is this NEC-7720, which is a digital signal processor. So it's going to be massaging the analog signals that it gets in off the telephone line, and presumably creating analog signals based on what the UART and the processor is telling it to do, and firing them both directions down the telephone line. What else is going on here? Four banks of dip switches for setting up your different user configurations. I couldn't find a manual for this to figure out what all these different modes are. I'm assuming there's some auto answer and various other things on there. But those would be set them once and then forget them for your installation. Then on the front panel, like every modem from the day, it had had a bunch of LEDs telling you what's going on inside it. Three speeds, 2400, 1200, 300 baud, off hook. Hang on, where's my cheat sheet here? I couldn't actually find all of them, and I just couldn't find a manual for this thing. What a surprise. So we got off hook, terminal ready, modem ready, error, I think. Can't figure that one out. TM, carry detect, clear to send and receive data and transmit data. Those would be flashing in response to either what the processor is determining from the UART and or from the control signals that are coming in on the RS-232. Anybody who has used RS-232 serial ports, actual hardware serial ports, recently has probably used the 9-pin version. This is the 25-pin version. It's got a whole bunch more handshaking signals that nobody's used since probably the late 90s. Other things on the front, some troubleshooting buttons, again, who I can't figure out or I can't find any information on. But just for when you're testing your installation, or putting it, probably taking it on and offline. I'm not 100% sure there. What else is going on? Oh, power supply mode. Yeah. So there's the obvious power supply right back here. There's half a dozen diodes down here. Just your standard 4001 or 4004, something like that, diodes. Just straight up rectification off the AC coming in here from the transformer. Some smoothing capacitors for the various voltages. This guy, LM309K, is a 5-amp linear regulator, which the data sheet says, where did it go here? 5 volts and in excess of 1 amp. That's not much of a brag, is it? Anyway, the other two voltage regulators are these two little guys down here, and they are part numbers you might recognize, 75 or 7805 and 7905. 7905 creates a negative 5 volts and 7805 a positive 5 volts. So again, that's coming out of that center tap supply, so you can get a plus and a minus out of it. What else? Oh, looking around here, I've noticed there are a handful of bodge wires going on. Not too many. I've seen a lot worse on a lot of old circuitry. There's another guy down there, a bodge resistor, which is unusual, but really there's only those ones that I've seen on here. Another interesting piece of design, every single one of these chips has a bypass capacitor right tight beside it. Every single one. Which is pretty interesting. I mean, it just goes to show that's something that you still do today, right? That's completely normal. These two relays over here, I'm not sure why there's two of them, but one of them, this one I think, based on where the traces are going, is for taking it on and off hook, basically connecting it to the telephone line or disconnecting it. This guy looks like a gas tube surge suppressor to me. And that will be just in parallel with the two wires of the tip and ring of the telephone line. And it's completely circuit protection. A lightning bolt coming in this way would give all these guys a real hard time. So, this thing acts sort of like an MOV these days that you'd use. If there's a high voltage spike, it just shorts it, it clamps it down so that it can't go any further. And they can take repeated hits, actually. They are still used, or versions of that are still used in the telephone system today out in the street. So I don't know what else there is to say about this old guy. I found very few references about it when I was searching, about this particular model anyway. If you search for Gandalf modem, you'll find some other ones, some newer than this one, and you'll find some of their taxi stuff and their PBX stuff and whatnot. But I couldn't find a picture of this one online. What I did find, though, is in the April 1985 issue of Computing Now magazine, which was a relatively short-lived Canadian computing magazine, only, I think, 20 issues or something. But I was a charter subscriber back in the 80s. They had a short blurb saying that this modem sold at introduction for 995 Canadian dollars. Wow. So, obviously, a lot of home users weren't using these things, right? These were used for businesses, and that's where I got this one. It was hitting the dumpster from a business. And this particular one was actually their spare. And they were just cleaning out the storage room and found it and said, "Wow, what an antique. We don't want this anymore." Anyway, let's plug it in and power it on. Ooh, the monster lives. So it comes up in 2400 baud mode, I think. Which one? One of these. Yeah, it turns on some of those. So it takes it off hook, modem ready, carrier detects, except for it's not detecting any carrier, and clear to send. The rest of them don't seem to have any effect on those. And I could probably tinker with the dip switches a little bit to get a few more lights lit up, but doesn't matter. Just interesting to see that even after all these decades, it still powers up, doesn't go kaboom. Neato. Do you think any technology from today will still power up and just sit there dutifully waiting for you after 85, 95, 05, 15, after 30 plus years? I doubt it very much. Anyway, there it is in all its 1985 glory.